So, ladies and gentlemen, now I am very, very, very excited to introduce you to my dear friend, but more importantly, one of the leading voices across the country and around the world in healthcare innovation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Anna Barker.
So anyway, thank you, Joan, and thank you to AZBio for inviting me today. Entrepreneurs change the world. How many entrepreneurs in the room? Everybody should raise. What is this? Everybody in this room is an entrepreneur, right? So how many entrepreneurs again? Oh, really? Okay. So entrepreneurs change the world, and in bioscience, entrepreneurs really change the world. And I would argue that most of the advances that we're talking about today, so many of them are coming from people like you who actually are willing to take risks and be innovative and do the thing that no one believes is going to work. And my mantra on this is, if somebody tells you that it's not going to work, if you start something and you get a lot of press that's very negative, you're probably doing a very good thing. So keep at it. I want to talk to you today a little bit about is innovation our best hope to deal with the healthcare, what I think is a crisis, and I think we kind of all agree with that, for a whole range of different reasons. But we have to figure out what innovation is to some extent, and we have to figure out how to enable it if that's possible. And I believe that it actually is possible. So I want to start with my vision of healthcare. You kind of have to see this all together. It's a train wreck. And if you look at my train wreck, you'll see yourself up there somewhere. Because this healthcare debacle that we have created is, in fact, the making of every sector and every aspect, actually, of our economy, including certainly our government, which, you know, we hope someday will come to agreement on what kind of healthcare bill we should have, which is going to require a transparent process, I think. So we all own this, and I think we have to figure our way out of it. And as I said to Joan this morning, we talk about how our country is placed in healthcare and how much better healthcare is somewhere else. And for those of you that travel and look at the world of healthcare, this is still the best place in the world to get the best healthcare. And we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We want to actually fix this train wreck and preserve the parts of the train wreck that have to be preserved. So where are we today in terms of precision medicine? The reality is that we focus on sick people. We rarely focus on early diagnosis or prevention, the kinds of things that we talk incessantly about, but we don't do enough about. And if you look at that, that's been our mantra for decades, and we are beginning to learn how to profile patients earlier and to begin to know about how to detect disease earlier. I would say, except for primary prevention, stop smoking, don't eat all that lunch, don't have the dessert, don't smoke. All those things we know are bad for us. But in fact, the science that I'm going to tell you a little bit about today, we're just beginning to learn about how that might apply in prevention. So this is the one that gets everybody's attention. Healthcare spending last year was around 17% of the GDP. It's projected to grow to about 20%. And as you heard from Joan when she started her conversation with you, that is unsustainable, and we have to fix it. And it's not all about the price of pharmaceuticals, which is all we seem to be talking about. As a matter of fact, that's a very minor part of healthcare cost. What we're talking about in terms of that healthcare train wreck, which is producing a lot of these issues, is going to continue with us for the foreseeable future. We're thinking it's going to grow another 4% per year to reach this 20%, and I don't think anyone knows what happens after that. So, what are we looking for? We want to focus on predisposition to disease. When can we know, and what do we know, and how can we fix things before they occur? And that's based on molecular profiling, by and large, which I've had something to do with. And diagnosis and molecular diagnostics, which is an industry that has been, in my opinion, totally paralyzed for the last three decades for reasons that have to do with economics and regulatory issues. Not of FDA's making, by the way. The other issue that I think is going to be really, really important is that we start actually turning some of this molecular information into new treatments that are going to work for patients and work for the patients for which they are intended. And right now, we treat, in cancer, my area, we treat everybody. If you have breast cancer, you have prostate cancer, whatever cancer you have, you get standard of care, and standard of care is the same for everybody in that particular class with that particular cancer. And so we want to move to a new system of healthcare based on the convergence of research and clinical care, and have that be a continuum. We learn and we change. We learn and we change the healthcare paradigm as we go. So precision or personalized medicine, which is what we're all talking about, and we're talking about it as though it exists and it's implemented, and it isn't. So the issue for people like us and the people are in this room and in rooms like this across the country, essentially, are how do we actually implement this so that every patient has access to precision healthcare? And that's going to require three or four things. So if you don't take away anything else from what I have to say while you're eating, patiently listening to this, is that, number one, we are still unraveling the complexity of these diseases, and it's going to go on for some time. We're just on the leading edge of this. We're just getting started. So we should not kid ourselves how much we actually know about these diseases, because genomics, which is an area where I've had a fair amount of influence, is the first piece of this puzzle. And it's certainly not going to be the last piece. The other thing is that this is a very complex set of initiatives that go on in the human being, and we're only just beginning to know about this. So we have to continue to ensure that the disciplines that actually can underlie healthcare, and that's not just biology, it's going to be physics, it's going to be mathematics, it's going to be engineering. All of those things have to come together in ways that we're just beginning to think about. And finally, we need collaboration, trans-sector collaboration. And I work in a world, and I've worked in a world for a long time in the federal government, where it's really hard sometimes for people to see the advantage of academics, for example, working with the private sector. There is this divide that we, in the entrepreneurial world, I think, do better than the large companies do. And above all, we need innovation. So let's talk about that. So there are certain things that are driving us right now, and we know about some, and I'm only going to talk about a couple, but there are so many forces that created that train wreck. I want to talk about what's paralyzing us, and then what opportunities can come from the paralysis. And I think there are lots of ideas in here for people to start new companies, by the way, and to make the companies that you've started a lot better. So if I take the disease that I care the most about, cancer, in our country, it's projected to increase about 30 to 35% in as little as 15 years. Because of the aging of our population and the aging of the population around the world, this is not unusual. When I was at the National Cancer Institute, I consulted with countries every week that were trying to put together a cancer plan, because their countries are now becoming victims of this cancer epidemic or pandemic. And worldwide, then, we're looking at, the World Health Organization tells us, it's going to be 70% increase in cancer. If you can even imagine that, can you imagine a 40% increase with what we're paying now for cancer? So you add Alzheimer's to that, you add diabetes to that, you add some of the rare diseases to that, it's not just unsustainable, it's unimaginable. So if you look at what's driving everything today, it's advanced technologies. The elephant in our room here is that biology is driven by technology. And when I say that, you know, if you were all a group of academic investigators, you would say, no, it's driven by the brilliance of the thinking minds, et cetera, et cetera. That's true, but the data comes from technology. And right now, the advanced technologies are driving us, and these are the technologies, starting with genomics. But the genome is translated across the transcriptome, to the proteome, to the epigenome, and all of a sudden we find ourselves in a world of complexity that we only never dreamed about, but we're beginning to dream about, and we only started to anticipate about 5 years ago. So if I look at the genomics revolution, it started in cancer. It's going everywhere. How many people in this room have had their genome sequenced? 23andMe, well, that'll serve you. Anybody had 23andMe? All right, so anybody had a full sequence done, you had to pay a lot for it, so you'd have it on a little card. Okay, we're gonna have this meeting in 5 years, and 80% of you will have had your genome sequence. It's gonna cost you less than $500, and you're gonna know an incredible amount about yourself. And that's what's going to change, I think, most of this conversation. So if I look at the omics revolution, it's not just genomics, it's all the omics, and everyone has their own. We sequenced about 1 million genomes last year. This started with the completion of the human genome, which was completed a couple times, but finally in 2003. So 1 million genomes. Last year, that was approaching 30 petabytes of data. We have never seen this kind of data in the world of biomedicine. We've seen it in astronomy and a couple of other places, but not in biomedicine. So that led Francis Collins and I, the Human Genome Project, to propose in 2004 to actually sequence all the cancer genes. So we started a project called the Cancer Genome Atlas, and it was a very bold, very large project, and it looked like this. When I say big science, this is more than 300 people working together every day, 60 institutions. Francis and I took a lot of heat on this project. A lot of people wrote and said, what a really stupid idea this is. And like I said, you know, if it's a really good idea, then a lot of people who are threatened are going to say it's a really stupid idea. So we got a lot of press on this, and it was, you know, we didn't have to write much about it because everybody else wrote about it. But it was a very big project, and it was a risky project because we were pushing the edges of technology. But this is what we were able to do with a project like this. 300 people integrating their work across 60 institutions could take, this is a brain tumor, glioblastoma, which is the most severe tumor that we have to take care of in medicine, actually. This kills every patient, essentially. Most are dead in 6 months. The treatment for this disease has not changed in 100 years. The standard of care is pretty much awful, and we don't have any new drugs for this tumor. So my thought was, let's sequence this tumor. We're going to know an enormous amount about the molecular biology of this tumor, which we do now, and it hasn't changed this disease one bit. So I want you to think about that for a second, because we know which pathways are involved. We know the four subtypes that exist for this cancer, but we still haven't been able to create those therapeutics that will actually stop the growth of this tumor. So this has been done for 20 different cancers. So we have this kind of information about ovarian cancer, colon cancer, you name it, the leukemias, et cetera. That's producing something that we had not thought about. When we started this, we did not realize that we were going to become the data producers of all time. It started with the Cancer Genome Atlas. And what we thought, Dr. Collins and I, we'd spend more time coming up with the Cancer Genome Atlas, which is TCGA, which is the acronym, than we actually really spent time thinking about how we're going to store the data. You'd think the NIH would have enormous data capacity, but they didn't have. So we overwhelmed the NIH data capacity within 2 weeks of starting this project. So we had to, this is the NIH, you know, this is essentially someone who should be thinking about this kind of thing. It did force them to think, and now they actually are pretty well positioned. But what you see now and what you're all living with and you're all going to make money from if you're positioned in healthcare is big data. And people talk about it like they know what they're talking about. They don't. But essentially, the variety, the velocity, and ultimately the volume, none of those things have been anticipated. So now we're at a place where this big data explosion is actually overwhelming us, and it's paralysis. We are paralyzed right now. And some of the students in the room are working on this. And many of the students in the room are going to end up knee-deep, if not up to their necks, in this kind of technology. Because the kind of technologies we have now are not going to be sufficient. The thing I want to point out with this slide is that 90% of this data has been produced in 2 years. So that's the start of this curve, and less than 1% of it has been analyzed. So when you start thinking about the velocity, the volume, and the extent to which it's going to pile up, without the analytics, we're not going to be able to go very far in terms of solving our healthcare problems. But what this should point out to all of us, disease is digital information. The genome is digital. It's the zeros and ones. And we're going to now become data scientists. Everybody's going to become a data scientist. You already are. If you're working in genomics, you're working in medicine today, you're already seeing this. So this has led to sort of the fourth paradigm that we talk about in healthcare, which is essentially data science. And if you haven't read this book, it's worth your while, the fourth paradigm. So this is not a straightforward problem, is it? I mean, so analysis of 1% of the data, the fact that we know the molecular profiles of many of these diseases, but it's not helping us yet. It's not really doing as much as it should. You're all talking about immunotherapy as an example, but right now it's probably 7% of patients that respond to immunotherapy. The problem is we don't know which 7%. So when you read these wonderful stories of immunotherapy, and I am an immunologist by training, we don't know. We don't have the diagnostics yet to find those patients. And the cost of those therapies is astronomical. And so we have to know which patients to treat. So the reason this is not straightforward is, you know, all those ribbons you saw up there? All those ribbons represent different groups of patients. This represents different patients. Every patient, as it turns out, has a bit of a different molecular profile. That GBM slide that I showed you where we took, you know, that's 500 patients. Every single little line on that slide was a different patient. And if I showed you the copy number changes of all those patients, they're all different. However, what it allows you to think about is how you put this information together so that you can group these patients according to the major mutations that they actually have in what pathways. So if you think about snowflakes, snowflakes have taken on a whole new meaning in this culture. I just hear people talk about snowflakes now. Not those snowflakes we're talking about. We're talking about these snowflakes. So essentially what this says to us is that those GBM subtypes that we were able to analyze and identify, that we have to consider in that graph that every single patient in there has a unique profile. So if you're a physician taking care of that patient, you have to understand his phenotype and how that's expressed. And it's a little different in every patient. So this is our challenge in precision medicine. So there's a lot of data. We're already awash in data. And let's talk about one area here where everybody in this room could start to think about how they make a difference, especially if you're in the diagnostics world. So biomarkers. We talk about them like we know what they are. Everybody has their own view of what a biomarker is. If you talk in medicine today, you say, I have a biomarker for this. And biomarkers are in the eye of the beholder, in my opinion. And I'm sorry about this green. I think you can read this. Essentially what this says, this is the new definition of a biomarker from the FDA and NIH, a group that I work with, to come up with. I have to tell you, this took weeks to come up with this. No one agreed on what this should say. And if you read, it's like every other government, you know, kind of thing that we do. But essentially, it's a defined characteristic. If you can measure it reproducibly, then you can tell us something about the disease, the natural state of the disease, and whether or not someone's responding to an intervention. So that's kind of what a biomarker is. For example, your blood pressure is a biomarker. We use it actually to approve drugs. Your cholesterol level is a biomarker. It's used to approve drugs. In cancer, we don't have very many biomarkers. My colleague and partner at ASU, George Post, published this paper a long time ago. But what he showed us is that there are hundreds of thousands of biomarkers published. We have less than 100 that we use in oncology and probably less than 20 used in the clinic. They don't fare very well at FDA. So if you look at this graph, what you'll see is that most biomarkers are proteins, and we've approved less than one per year since the early 90s. The science isn't very good yet. So what you'll read about, if you read the New York Times and other places, you'll read that a lot of this data is not reproducible. As a matter of fact, it's been published a lot that 80% of the literature in biomedicine is not reproducible. Not surprising to those of us that live in this world, because reproducing an experiment is really hard if you don't have every single nuance of that experiment. But this is a key issue for us, because the biomarkers are in the data. The biomarkers are in the data. And we need the analytics, and we need the technology to find the signals. So people who know how to look into data are going to find these signals, and they're going to help us to actually find a solution to this problem, which is a biomarker-related problem. Pharmaceuticals are failing. And if you've been following the news over the last 6 months, we've had massive failures, big ones, ones that have sent stock way down. And this is the attrition that we see in cancer. We probably are losing 70% of our clinical trials. And that is totally unsustainable. So I was in a meeting with Vice President Biden and a bunch of pharma CEOs recently, and he was just beating the crap out of them because of their costs. And they were trying to explain this, and they don't explain it very well, by the way. But essentially, yeah, you know, why are pharmaceuticals so expensive? If you're the Vice President, then he was the Vice President of the United States. He kept saying, no, I don't understand you. I don't understand. Need to understand you. You just need to lower the prices of drugs. And, you know, that was a short conversation. But this is one of the major reasons that we have this problem, is we spend so much on developing these drugs that fail. So what we have to think about, and what are, I think, people probably 30 and younger are going to think more about than maybe some of us, essentially, is all of that biological information occurs in real time, in three dimensions, and it's translated over all kinds of layers, from the genome up to who you are. That's the problem. You know, how do we translate it over all these levels? And we think it's simple, and it's obviously not simple. So disease is not just digital information. It's how that's interpreted. So everybody around the room is going to have a little different genomic profile, and their phenotype is going to be a little different. So it's going to be about how the information is actually gathered and how it's interpreted. And we need disciplines to come together to do this. So people ask me, why did I come to Arizona from Washington? Because this is the most innovative place that I saw, and that was 5 years ago. And 5 years hence, I really believe it is one of the most innovative, culturally rich, entrepreneurial friendly sorts of places that I've ever seen. And shame on us if we don't solve some of these problems. So the question is, can we do this? There are some national initiatives to talk about. I mentioned the Vice President, former Vice President. He, in fact, shocked everybody. I know this story well because his son, Beau Biden, died of a brain tumor, which is what I work on. And I know the individual who took care of him is a good friend of mine, and we're partnered on a project, a big project. But he decided, with the loss of his son, that he would dedicate the rest of his life to this problem. And that's been a huge boon. This is the first kind of emphasis at this level we've had on cancer since 1971, when Nixon actually came up with the National Cancer Act. But he wants us to make a decade's worth of progress in 5 years. And there's been a lot of discussion about what that means, but I got to tell you, he doesn't settle. If you get in a room with him and you start telling him how something's impossible, he'll tell you how to make it possible. So this guy's going to be a force, and he's actually focused on a few areas. He's focused on what I just talked about: data, data sharing, data standards, and collaboration number one. What he found out is this: the biomedical community isn't all that collaborative. So, you know, hell is essentially where nothing connects. And in many ways, this is the big source of the problems we have in our space. And so I'll tell you, in just in a short period of time, how we're trying to fix some of that. So along the lines that he was moving on cancer, Fred Upton and Diane DeGette were moving over 3 years on another initiative called the 21st Century Cures Bill. And Fred Upton, I don't know if you know him, he's from Michigan. I went to Ohio State. I still like the guy. He's very dedicated to this cause, and he believed in what he did, as did Diane. She's the Democrat on that bill. And they have pushed this for 3 years. They listened to 1,000, 2,000 people in over 3 years in terms of building this bill. So this has been very thoughtfully approached. The president was all over this, supported it, gave his support actually to the vice president. And as you know, ultimately this was renamed the Biden initiative in honor of the vice president's son. It passed with virtually almost unanimously. Five people, I think, voted against it. This is what it does for us in terms of NIH. It's a lot of money. It's $4.8 billion. As you've probably heard in the last couple of days, the budget that is on the table has put this at risk. I guess after a decade in the government, I worry a little less about this kind of thing. Congress makes these appropriations decisions. The money that is appropriated comes from Congress. And I can tell you they do like this bill and they like the NIH. So I think we'll be okay here. I don't think we'll get everything, but I think we'll get a lot of it. And as you can see, it had to also address some other issues, brain diseases, grants for states, which I think could be a big deal for a place like ours. And then $500 million for the FDA, which is a pittance of what they should get. And then, as you know, addiction is also part of this bill. And I have to say, I'll show you a picture. I was since I wrote a piece of this bill, I was there. And I just gathered up a few photos from it. And I wanted to show you a couple of them to show you how the world of politics works. Toward the top of that, you'll see the president talking, and the vice president had just kind of introduced him. It was really funny. The dynamic was funny because the vice president was introducing him. He was taking a long time, and the president said, "Well, just get on with it, Joe," you know, kind of thing. So that happened. But I thought this was an especially in your upper right-hand corner. That's Rob Califf, the former commissioner of the FDA, and I think this will be one of the few pictures he's ever going to have with the president because he had to leave almost immediately after this was done. So I sent him this picture, and I'm sure he's going to put it up on his wall. And the people that actually were responsible for the bill are in the on the lower part of this. And the two people to the right of the screen over there, that's Diane DeGette and Fred Upton, who actually authored this bill. So if you ever get a chance to thank them, they are really supporters of ours. So I want to say a few things about a collaboration and just quickly tell you about a collaboration that we're doing here in Arizona that's gotten quite a bit of national attention, and it's addressing this biomarker issue to show you how you take on an impossible issue. Well, you know Mike Crow. That's how you take it on. I mean, he gives you the latitude to say, if it'll change the world, then let's go do something about this. So I said when I first came here, I pointed out to him that Janet Woodcock, who's the head of he's actually the brains and I think the heart of the Food and Drug Administration. Scott Gottlieb is the new commissioner coming in. I think he'll be a good commissioner, but Janet runs the drug center at FDA. She wrote a piece before I left the Cancer Institute. We worked together on a lot of projects, but she said the two issues that have to be resolved are biomarkers and better clinical trials. So we've kind of taken on both of those in my work here at ASU. And one of the things we've done, and you're welcome to join us in this, is to set up a nonprofit. We brought a lot of people, several thousand people, to Arizona over the last couple of years to talk about what are the problems in biomarker science. And our mission is to fix these problems. It's a long, you know, sort of fancy statement there, but you can go and read about us on nbdabiomarkers.org. These are some of the workshops that we've had. We've had many think tanks and workshops to figure out what is wrong. And we figured it out took a lot of time, but it came down to, as all simple things, it came down to six simple problems. Number one, people do not know how to design an experiment. Number two, they don't know how to design an experiment that asks a relevant clinical question. That's why most things fail. Number three, they don't know how to collect biospecimens. And if they do, there are not enough of them, or they're really bad. Number four, they know there are technology standards, but they don't use them. Number five, they don't know how to collect data, and they don't collect metadata. And number six, they don't know how to analyze data. So that's it. That's what we've learned. And I know, it's pretty simple, but we're trying to attack each one of those modules, because it's just like a pharmaceutical. If you don't kill it early, it's going to cost you a lot of money. And so unless you kill these biomarkers early, those of you in the diagnostics world or even in the clinical trials world, you're going to spend a lot of money finding out that it's wrong. So we're taking on every one of those modules and working them out through our national network. So you're welcome to join us. I have two of our staff here today, Carrie Treadwell, Kristen Panotta, who's here. Don't try to steal them. They're really good at what they do, but they work with us on the National Biomarker Development Alliance, and it's a very successful, series of initiatives. I'm not talking about one we're doing in brain tumors today, but we've designed, through NBDA, we brought together a global group to design the most advanced clinical trial that FDA has ever done. And we got the blessing to get it underway last November, and we're just now putting it out there into China, Australia, and the US. And it all came out of this small foundation that we created here in Arizona. So thanks to people like the folks that are sitting here. So I think that we're going to get to precision medicine. I believe we will. It's going to depend on people like us doing extraordinary things to really unravel the complexity of these diseases, to ensure that these scientific disciplines come together and work together. And in places like ASU, we really strive to do that, and that we collaborate. And collaborations like this one are the ones that matter. And finally, but not last, innovation. Now, let's talk about what that means. I don't know. Do you know? No one knows. But you know it when you see it, don't you? I mean, it's very interesting what innovation is. But this is just someone I'm related to by marriage over here, Tony Dennis. He writes and thinks about innovation, and these are some of the things that people who are experts in innovation tell us. You know, what makes you wonder? What makes you come up with good ideas? Speculate about what could be. And it's usually students that do this. Can you define it? I don't know, but is it a new question? Is it a new idea? Is it a unique insight at the intersection of fields? And a lot of these things come from, a lot of our advances in biomedicine do not come from biomedicine. They come from outside biomedicine, and increasingly that's going to be true. And then can you combine insights from other fields? This is something that the computer industry, for example, does so well. And is it disruptive to current dogma? I love that one, because I hate dogma. I hate it, because essentially it forces people to do things because they're expected to do them. And it actually makes them think within the box, not outside the box. And then, does it challenge assumptions? And in biomedicine, that's really hard, because we are pretty unionized, and we control the way that things get done way too much, in my opinion, especially in the academic world. So if it were me, I would really get comfortable with change, because as this very wise person pointed out, Charles Darwin, who should certainly know, it's not the strongest of the species, it's actually those that can actually adapt to change. And if it were me, I would be looking at how to change this data paradigm, how to come up with new ways to analyze data, how to find signal in all that noise, and how to turn it into products that can help patients. So coming to talk to a group like this, I have all the faith in the world that all these, especially the bright young faces out here who know a lot more about how to look at data than many of us, are going to change the world. So thank you very much, Joan, for having me.